Okay, good evening. Welcome to the George W. Bush Conference Plenary Forum, Waging War in Afghanistan and Iraq. My name is Paul Fritz. I'm an associate professor of political science at Hofstra, and I'm very pleased to be serving as moderator for this distinguished forum. The wars in Iraq and Afghanistan are arguably the most controversial and most consequential foreign policy decisions of the George W. Bush administration. The decision to go to war, how to fight the wars, how to get out of the wars, and related issues not only dominated the bulk of President Bush's time in office, but have also shaped current U.S. Foreign policy options in and around the regions and beyond, and will continue to do so into the foreseeable future. And there's very little doubt that the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq will continue to be measures by which the legacy of the George W. Bush foreign policy will be measured. So with that in mind, the conference organizers, and most importantly, Director Mina Bose and Associate Director Richard Himmelfarb, have brought together this outstanding panel of public servants, journalists, and scholars to examine the way the Bush administration waged wars, the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq, and the consequences of these wars. So each of our panelists is extremely accomplished, and I will try to keep the introductions relatively brief, although that's hard with a group like this. But as I go through, I would ask that you please hold your applause until I've introduced everyone, and we can welcome them all together. So from giving us perspectives from the administration, we first have Thomas Basile, who's currently a national political commentator, appearing on venues such as Forbes and SiriusXM Patriot Radio, and is president of Empire Solutions. For the Bush administration, in 2003 through 2004, Mr. Basile was a senior press advisor to the Coalition Provisional Authority in Iraq. After this, in 2004, he was a consultant for the Republican National Committee presidential campaign. And prior to this service, he was Director of Communications for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency in 2001 through 2003, and was part of the 2000 Bush-Cheney campaign. Last but certainly not least, Mr. Basile is a Hofstra alum, graduating with a degree in political science, and he was named the 2007 Hofstra Young Alumnus. Ambassador James Nicholson is currently senior counsel at Brownstein, Hyatt, Farber, Schreck, counseling clients in foreign policy, healthcare, state and federal, regulatory law, international relations, real estate, oil and gas, and alternative energy. From 2005 until 2009, Ambassador Nicholson was the U.S. Secretary of Veterans Affairs. Excuse me. Before this appointment, he was U.S. Ambassador to the Holy See from 2001 to 2005, during which time he was knighted by Pope John Paul II for his work on human rights. Ambassador Nicholson has also served as chairman of the Federal Interagency Council on Homelessness, the director of the New Community Development Corporation, commissioner, and commissioner of the Defense Advisory Committee on Women and the Services. Ambassador Nicholson was also chairman of the Republican National Committee from 1997 to 2001. Lawrence Wilkerson is currently a distinguished adjunct professor of government and public policy at the College of William & Mary. Colonel Wilkerson served in the United States Army from 1966 until 1997. Excuse me. While in uniform, he was a member of the faculty at the U.S. Naval War College, Special Assistant to General Colin Powell when Powell was Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and Director and Deputy Director of the U.S. Marine Corps War College at Quantico, Virginia. From 2001 until 2002, he was Associate Director of the State Department Policy Planning Staff. Colonel Wilkerson's last position in government was Chief of Staff for U.S. Secretary of State Colin Powell from 2002 until 2005. The journalists and scholars that we have present. First, Anand Gopal. He is a journalist that served as an Afghanistan correspondent for the Wall Street Journal for the Christian Science Monitor and has reported on the Middle East and South Asia for Harper's, The Nation, New Republic, and several other publications. Mr. Gopal is one of the few journalists who has extensively interviewed all sides in the Afghanistan conflict. And this is cited extensively in his critically acclaimed book, No Good Men Among the Living, America, the Taliban, and the War Through Afghanistan Eyes, which was a finalist for the 2014 National Book Award and the 2015 Helen Bernstein Award. And by the way, it was just announced yesterday, recipient of the Ridenour Prize. Congratulations. Mr. Gopal is also an Insight Fellow at Columbia University and is formerly a Bernard Schwartz Fellow at the New America Foundation. Peter Baker is the Chief White House Correspondent for the New York Times and a contributing writer for the New York Times Magazine. He's covered three presidents for the Times in his previous position with the Washington Post. And for his work, Mr. Baker won the Gerald R. Ford Prize for Distinguished Reporting on the Presidency and the Otto Beckman Memorial Award for White House coverage. In between his White House assignments, Mr. Baker was also the Moscow bureau chief for the Washington Post during the rise of Vladimir Putin. Mr. Baker is the author of Days of Fire, Bush and Cheney in the White House, which provides a comprehensive look at the Bush administration from the controversial 2000 election to the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq to the last moments of the Bush and Cheney White House. Mr. Baker is also serving as the Joseph G. Aspman Distinguished Conference Scholar for this conference. And Phyllis Bennis is the director of the New Internationalism Project at the Institute for Policy Studies in Washington, D.C., and is also a fellow of the Transnational Institute in Amsterdam. Ms. Bennis has been a writer, an analyst, an activist on Middle East and UN issues for many years and speaks widely across the U.S. and around the world as part of the global peace movement. She continues to serve as an informal advisor for several top UN officials on Middle East issues and UN democratization issues. Ms. Bennis is the author of 8 books, and including, most relevant to this panel, the 2003 book, Before and After, U.S. Foreign Policy and the War on Terror, and the 2005 book, Challenging Empire, How People, Governments, and the UN Defy U.S. Power. So please join me in welcoming this distinguished panel that we have this evening. So for the format, we are going to have 10 to 12 minutes for each of our guests here. And then there will be a question and answer session, and possibly in between a moderated discussion, depending on how much time we have. So we will essentially go in the order that was listed in the program. So first, Mr. Basile.
Thank you, Paul, for that introduction. It's always a pleasure to be back here on Hofstra's campus. I was thinking today as I was walking through that it was 18 years ago that I served as a student on the planning committee for the Bush 41 conference. And during the conference, I got to trail around John Sununu for 3 days, who happens to be the fastest walker I'd ever encountered. And today, Joe is following me around now two decades later, and Joe, I'm sorry, you got stuck with me. I really appreciate the invitation of Dr. Bose and the Calico Center to be here, not only as an alumnus of the administration, but also as an alumnus of this institution. It is wonderful to see Hofstra's place in the policy and the political discourse surrounding the American presidency increase so dramatically over the last number of years. It's particularly good to see Secretary Nicholson here, with whom I was so fortunate and to share a very wonderful and, for me, a very meaningful and very emotional moment in American history when we were both able to attend President Bush's meeting with John Paul II at the Vatican in 2002. So it is good to see you, sir. For millennia, the causes of war and the strategies associated with it were defined by particular margins involving a combination of sort of resource and territorial acquisition, therefore producing the resulting subjugation or oppression of conquered populations. And I suggest that for most people, this paradigm continues to drive perceptions of war and war making. I submit that with the close of the Cold War and the rise of the United States hegemony in the world, the proliferation of technology, the breakdown of certain alliances, that what we witnessed in the rise of Al-Qaeda and the decision-making of the United States in the aftermath of 9/11 was a sharp departure from the usual war-making paradigm. In fact, I believe that we are still in many respects in a transitional phase as it relates to the way that this country handles both its military and its diplomatic strategy to account for this shift. The administration of George W. Bush was the first such administration to have to deal with this paradigm shift. During the Bush presidency, the White House was faced with the challenge of handling both the traditional territorial and institutional impacts of war in the form of external forces such as terror groups, embedding and influencing the governments of state actors, the viral nature of the radical Islamic terrorist movement, and the exploitation by governments of state actors of the new global paradigm that had emerged after the end of the Cold War. It was a historically complicated confluence of forces and circumstances that led to both the Afghanistan and Iraq missions. The Bush administration had to cope with the concept of trying to fight mobile terrorist groups in dozens of countries while fighting traditional territorial battles, rebuilding infrastructure and institutions in Afghanistan that perhaps may not have existed, and in the case of Iraq, projecting out the impact that state actors might have who may exploit and support the efforts of the terrorist enemy. And we've spent a great deal of time over the last decade and a half on whether we should have gone into Afghanistan or whether we should have gone into Iraq. And I personally view the decision-making process through what my old boss, Paul Bremer, calls the reasonable man test. It comes from the old chancery courts. Would a reasonable principal, in this case the President of the United States, faced with the confluence of circumstances that I just described in a general sense, buttressed by specific intelligence, act in a certain way? Keeping in mind, of course, that Saddam Hussein had been declared a state sponsor of terrorism and regime change had been the policy of the U.S. government since the Clinton administration. And when it comes to both Iraq and Afghanistan, I believe that President Bush made the correct choice for military intervention in both of those circumstances. However, I believe the more relevant conversation for all of us and for our country moving forward remains, once you make the decision to go to war, what is the principal purpose or desired outcome? Now you have several choices. You can remove Saddam Hussein or the Taliban and leave, which I believe is a false choice. You can, two, remove the leadership, then grab some general or expatriate and impose them with absolute authority, basically trading one dictator for another. And I think that particularly for Bush, the moral and political argument fails there as well. Or three, you could attempt to secure the country and build institutions that could support not what some people have suggested, something, you know, so-called American-style democracy, but a participatory, pluralistic, and tolerant governance structure. The Coalition Provisional Authority in Iraq was developed to execute option three, this historic gathering of now often maligned members of our military and civilian corps and our diplomats, had the responsibility to get the economy growing and establish security and a political framework that would accomplish goal number three, working together with an Iraqi population that was more supportive of the effort than is generally known or accepted. They tackled this extraordinary task with great passion and commitment, and they sacrificed much, with their efforts going largely unnoticed as the security situation worsened due to the rise of Al-Qaeda in Iraq and sectarian violence, and unfortunately, a White House that, as the mission went on, often failed to aggressively defend its own policy in Iraq. President Bush understood several key points very well. One, he believed that left unchecked, it was likely that Hussein would develop a nuclear weapons program. Two, Hussein had funded external terror groups, and he believed that it was likely that he would fund, if not Al-Qaeda, he would be supporting other terror groups. Three, the war on terrorism was a long-term, global threat that involved dozens of groups, some closely aligned, some loosely aligned, not only with each other, but also state actors, and also nation states as well. And we're seeing this today, as you see ISIS and Al-Qaeda and Boko Haram and Ansar al-Sharia and the Muslim Brotherhood and Hamas. All these folks are converging as a network, and a very powerful one at that. Fourth, he believed that this was a generations-long fight, and it would require long-term and aggressive engagement. And five, that addressing the freedom deficit in the Middle East and in countries that serve as incubators for these groups, however long-term and complex that strategy might be, was essential and an avenue toward ensuring a more peaceful world and further international cooperation to interdict terrorist networks. Where the strategy fell short, of course, was how to fight and manage all of these various components simultaneously. After all, we weren't just ejecting somebody from a country or protecting the territorial boundaries of a nation. We were trying to fight an insurgency while attempting to build new government and social and political institutions. On my first day in Iraq, I got off of the plane in searing heat at the Baghdad airport, and I put on my flak vest that didn't have any plates in it because the government didn't issue me any. And I put on my helmet and I got on the bus to go to the compound. And they said, by the way, the road is closed. The road between the airport and the compound was closed because the army was not able to secure it. They called it the road of death. People were dying on it virtually every day. So they closed the route. And from that point on, and that was my first day and my first hour, we knew that we were going to have a resource issue here. Manpower issues that plagued the Iraq mission early on and have been a constant struggle in Afghanistan were very real. The administration, particularly the Rumsfeld Pentagon, had a vision for a lighter, fleet-footed, high-tech 21st century army. And that vision has merit, but it was incompatible with the mission that we had at that particular time. For our part, nearly every civilian and military liaison that I worked with, right from the ambassador on down, agreed from the outset that we needed to maintain overwhelming force size in order to accomplish the mission. Today, at the White House, former Johns Hopkins University professor and noted economist Ashraf Ghani, the newly elected president of Afghanistan, came to Washington to tell the American people thank you for the work that it helped give them a shot to, instead of being a burden to the world, to actually have a shot at a free future. But we are clearly seeing the beginning of what the president called a generational process of development. In Iraq, despite poor intel regarding infrastructure, military assets, essential services, mass looting, a lack of indigenous security forces, the Iraq mission also realized a range of successes, also not sufficiently promoted by the administration and frequently ignored by the media. The training of new Iraqi security forces began within weeks of the creation of the CPA, which enabled anybody up to the grade of colonel to reapply to a new professional army. Ultimately, 80% of the officers and the NCOs in the new army were from the old army, but they were better paid, better trained, and better equipped. The central bank was reopened and the currency transitioned to a single stable unit within the first 6 months. It took us 2 years to do that in post-World War II Germany. Oil production increased. Dozens of schools and government buildings were rebuilt, including hospitals and healthcare centers. A constitution was developed with Shia, Sunnis, Kurds, and Turkmen all at the table. And systems were created to facilitate an election in an incredibly challenging and degrading security environment. And let's not forget that more than 8 million people voted in Iraq's first election. Perhaps most importantly, Al-Qaeda in Iraq had been decimated due to one of the boldest foreign policy decisions, in my opinion, of the last half century, made by President George W. Bush, the delayed, admittedly, but necessary surge. By the time Bush left office, the economy of Iraq had increased in size several times over from its time under Hussein. Per capita income had increased between 4 and 6 times. Life expectancy had risen, and security forces had secured much of the country due to the training and ongoing assistance from the United States. Despite the consequences of a precipitous withdrawal of troops administered by the current administration, and the insistence by both parties of this military strategy via CNN, which left Iraq all but defenseless in the face of ISIS, we also recently just saw the fourth peaceful transition of power between governments in Iraq, which is something that had never before been accomplished in the Middle East, with the exception of Israel. None of these positives, of course, can negate the challenges that persist, but they can, when added to the conversation, give us a better understanding of the need and the ability to move nations toward a freer, more pluralistic constructs. In my time in Iraq, I saw courage and conviction of an Iraqi people anxious to build a new nation. 1,000 acts of courage and unheralded successes every day, overshadowed by a security situation that we were unprepared to address. As we look back, there are many issues and many things to be learned. Few are certain that must inform our thinking. The world has changed. The challenges we face, have changed. But giving people a chance to be free and to self-govern is the surest way to a greater peace. I saw firsthand the consequences of authoritarianism and oppression and the evil that sapped the soul out of people and nations and regions in a way that we cannot fully appreciate here. And you haven't experienced the power of freedom until you talk to somebody who has never known it, and they realize for the first time that participatory government isn't some abstract theory. It is real, and it works, and it is achievable with great effort and great sacrifice. George W. Bush did not buy into the bigotry that suggests that there are certain people in this world who do not deserve or are too unsophisticated or incapable of handling what we call freedom. I consider it an honor to have served him, and I look forward to a meaningful discussion tonight. Thank you so much for your attention.
Good evening. I really appreciate being here at Hofstra University, participate in this panel with these distinguished people, and I appreciate what you're doing here at Hofstra with this conference on the George W. Bush presidency. And we won't agree here on everything that is said, I'm sure, but I bet there's one thing about which we can agree, and that is that whatever is said here tonight about the George W. Bush presidency will look different to us in 20 years and different again 20 years after that. George W. Bush's presidency must be defined by the events of September 11, 2001, when the United States of America was viciously attacked by an enemy whose leader, Osama bin Laden, stated as far back as 1983 that the United States was the mortal enemy of Islam and must be destroyed. On 9/11, President Bush declared to the people of America and to the world that he would do whatever was necessary to protect our country, to keep it safe, and to keep it free. This became the mantra of the G.W. Bush presidency. President Reagan had his mantra. It was to bring down the Soviet Union and end the Cold War. President Lincoln had his, slavery. So did President Bush. His global war on terror kept us safe and kept us free. So let's start with that. President Bush foretold the kind of decisive leader he would be at his acceptance speech in August 2000 at the Republican National Convention in Philadelphia. And I remember it well because I was there and I was the chairman of the convention as the chairman of the Republican National Committee. And then candidate Bush said, quote, "If you give me your trust, I will honor it. Grant me a mandate, I will use it. Give me the opportunity to lead this nation, and I will lead." Little did he know then of the events that would befall us all about 1 year later. But we found out soon thereafter just what a leader we had. It started immediately on 9/11. The context is worth a reminder. The president was at a school in Florida, but immediately authorized the shooting down of a civilian jetliner. The White House staff were told to evacuate, and evacuate in a hurry. In fact, the women were told to take off their shoes so that they could run faster down the street. The reason was they thought a plane was about to slam into the White House. The details stand out because you have to think about when the last time the White House was evacuated under similar circumstances. The only time that comes to mind is when the British burned the building during the War of 1812. Soon after, the president went to New York City to Game 3 of the World Series to throw out the first pitch. In a sense, that was a small act. Presidents throw pitches all the time. But in this case, in New York, while the fires were still burning at the World Trade Center, and when the entire nation was on edge about another terrorist attack, it was a big deal that the president went to the ballpark and stood on the mound. He demonstrated that he was not afraid, that we should not be afraid, and the game and the business and life of this nation must go on. The president addressed the nation at a joint session of Congress. He was in command, and he was comforting with his emphasis on safety and security and patriotism. An interesting side note to that speech is that on that date, which was September 20th, 2001, the Philadelphia Flyers faced the New York Rangers in an exhibition game in Philadelphia. The teams played two periods, and during the intermission before the third period was to start, the Jumbotron switched to the president's speech at the joint session in Washington. It was a live shot. When it was time to restart the game, the third period, the Jumbotron turned off the president and turned back to the game. The response was overwhelming. People started booing and demanding that the president be put back on. For a moment, Americans dropped professional sports and tuned in to hear what the president had to say. In the end, that game was called. They never played the third period, and they ended up in a draw. So I think we can stipulate that war defined President Bush's presidency. Presidential historian Arthur Schlesinger Jr. said of all national crises that confront presidents, war is the most fateful. And in his opinion, all of our best presidents were involved in war, either before or during their presidency, save Thomas Jefferson. Schlesinger further opined that crisis helps those who can rise to it, and the association of war with presidential greatness has its ominous aspects. Let's start with Afghanistan. Even the Pope supported our going into Afghanistan. I presented my credentials to the Holy Father, the leader of the Catholic Church and the leader of the sovereign state, the Holy See, on 9/13/01 at his summer palace in Castel Gandolfo. And we had prepared remarks. The State Department had helped me prepare, and he had his, and we just put those aside. The first thing we did was said a little prayer for the victims and then talked. And I, by then, was able to give him a brief of what we thought, the derivatives of what had happened were. And he said to me, Ambassador Nicholson, we must stop those people who are killing in the name of God. And that was not a privileged communication, so I was able to report that and put that out there, and it really helped us in putting a coalition together to go into Afghanistan. But the Pope did see Iraq differently. He expressed his opposition emphatically during his annual address to the Vatican Diplomatic Corps in January of 2003, and he looked directly at me and said, "No to war. War should only be the last resort." That was a disappointment to us after his affirmation of our efforts in Afghanistan, but it was not a surprise. But it did set off my biggest diplomatic challenge as the ambassador and our most robust endeavor to convince the Holy Father of the need for us to invade Iraq if Hussein would not bow to the demands of the UN under our lead. I enlisted the support of two distinguished Vaticanistas, as they call them, to come to Rome and assist me in an educative effort both at the Holy See and throughout Italy. And Professors Michael Novak and George Weigel, both possessing cherished, as they say over there, apartment welcome, which means they have wonderful bona fides with the Pope. But they felt the same way that we did and came immediately. We held several fora around the country and talked about the need, as we saw it, to go into Iraq. But the Pope continued to view this as preemptive. And in spite of these personal interventions, including those of the President himself, in a session with the Pope's personal emissary to the President, Cardinal Pio Laghi, who went to see the President in the West Wing of the White House for a long encounter, which I attended. The Pope dispatched a French Cardinal to Baghdad, Cardinal Etchegaray, to talk to the people there to see if they could get Hussein to come into line as being requested through the UN primarily. And of course, neither were successful. But the President understood and often said that the Pope is a man of peace and he had a different responsibility. Importantly, though, the Pope never said that it was immoral for us to go into Iraq. And he really couldn't, because it would be violative of the doctrine of the Church, which has been there for centuries, which recognizes that there are evil forces in the world, and there are innocent people who are entitled to be protected from those evil forces, and that does, on occasion, require the institution of war, of violence. In fact, today, in the train coming up to New York, I read a report from a distinguished writer for the Catholic News Service suggesting that Pope Francis may indeed end up advocating the use of force against ISIS. So there are precedents for this. And we, of course, were unsuccessful, as I've stated, with Pope John Paul II in trying to underwrite or affirm our endeavor to go into Iraq. But as we all know, on March 19th of 2003, we entered Iraq for the purpose of protecting our country and eradicating the threat to us and others possessed by Iraq's brutal dictator, Saddam Hussein. The case had been made to our citizens, to the UN, to our friends, to the Pope, and to the world, really. And the facts, as we saw them, were that Hussein was a threat. He had invaded two of his neighboring countries, Kuwait and Iran. He used weapons of mass destruction on his own people and on the Iranians. He shot at our planes and allies' planes. He was working to evade international sanctions. He failed to comply with numerous UN resolutions that required him to disarm and prove that he had. He paid the families of Palestinian suicide bombers. He gave every indication that he maintained stockpiles of weapons of mass destruction. He remained belligerent and violent, and refused to adhere to international demands, and showed every sign of being willing and interested in supporting attacks on the United States. Therefore, after 9/11, the United States could not afford to take the chance that he would unite with terrorists arrayed against us and provide them with weapons of mass destruction and other material support needed to attack American targets. Of course, no stockpiles of weapons of mass destruction were found. Nonetheless, Saddam Hussein was a threat to peace. And due to his recalcitrance and continued hostility to the world, we chose war. Hussein was toppled, and Iraq did catch a glimpse of freedom and democracy. Their courageous participation in their elections, as Tom has mentioned, demonstrated their hunger and their appreciation for freedom. In fact, I will never forget, just weeks after we went into Iraq, the Chaldean Catholic patriarch, whose name was Emmanuel Deli II, came to Rome and asked if he could visit me. And I received him at my residence in Rome, and he was the leader of about 850,000 Chaldean Catholics who have been there for centuries, and for whom Hussein sort of kept in a protected status in the, you know, in the dispute between the Sunni and the Shia. They were kind of off to the side, but he, in spite of the fact, knew that this had probably been disassembled. He didn't walk, he ran up the steps to my residence where I was standing and thrust his hand and said, "Thank you for coming to my country and freeing us," exhibiting that innate desire that man has for freedom, and the euphoria that he exhibited was exhilarating, of course, knowing even as he did the risks that they were now in as a result of this. But, you know, one can debate the conduct of this war, as many have, and one can argue that we should not have dismissed the Sunni Ba'ath Party-dominated army and the police forces. I think that would be a very legitimate thing. One can argue that we shifted emphasis too soon and too intensely on nation building and democracy building in lieu of law and order building and infrastructure, particularly law and order infrastructure. There were mistakes made, certainly. Abu Ghraib comes to mind. Those are fair discussions as far as I'm concerned. But I will end the way I started, which is to say again that President Bush, after we were invaded on 9/11, said he would do whatever was necessary to protect our country. He did. He kept Americans safe for the next 7 years as our president. Was war necessary? Was it worth it? Did it matter? The final report of the chief weapons inspector for the UN, Charles Dulfer, concluded, Saddam wanted to recreate Iraq's weapons of mass destruction capability after sanctions were removed and Iraq's economy stabilized. I agree with those who say that had Saddam done what we would have seen an arms race develop between Iraq and Iran and the Sunni-Shia terrorist arms race with the possibilities of biological, chemical, or even nuclear weapons being in the hands of terrorists. It would have increased greatly the possibilities of a dirty bomb being exploded in our country. The pressure on our friends like Israel, Kuwait, Saudi Arabia, and the UAE would be even greater today, and as a result, the American people would be less safe as well. Only time will tell about President Bush. All I can say is that he is looking better and better as the world becomes more and more dangerous, and we become more vulnerable to those who want to destroy us. What is a president's most important job? It's to keep us safe, and he did it. Thank you very much.
This on? Yeah. Okay. I'm going to take a little bit different tack. I'm going to try to look at, I hope I have time to look at three seminal episodes in what was my life after 9/11. Once the very chilling effects of that attack had sunk in, and we had realized at the State Department, I think it's safe to say throughout the government, the profundity of what had happened to us and what kind of reaction we were going to probably present to the world, we sat down on the policy planning staff, as did some other people at State, and we thought about it. One of the things that impressed us majorly was the phone calls, the letters, if you will, that were coming in, the TV scenes. It was a moment of incredible global solidarity. My God, we even got a condolence message from Fidel Castro. Le Monde, arguably the most influential paper in Paris, ran a headline, "Nous sommes tous Américains." We're all Americans. It was a moment of incredible solidarity, and my boss and his boss decided that one of the things we should try to do, remember, we're the diplomats, former soldiers, but we're diplomats now, was to capitalize on that moment of global solidarity. Not just for what we knew the president wanted to do with regard to Afghanistan, but in so many other realms that we had problems. So we drew up a matrix, and on that matrix were the missions and the countries and the people who would do it. In some cases, like Pakistan, it was the President of the United States and the Secretary of State who would talk to President Musharraf and the head of the Pakistani military and the ISS and so forth. In other countries, it was our ambassador. Donald Rumsfeld wanted to get back into the Philippines in a meaningful way, for example. Abu Sayyaf was a reasonably, shall we say, terrorist group in the Philippines that we could capitalize on. So we were going to try to talk with the Philippine government and get U.S. forces back into the Philippines in some significant sort of way. It was a huge task sheet that basically capitalized on this moment of global solidarity. Iraq completely shattered that. The invasion of Iraq and the run-up to that shattered that global solidarity. Shattered the diplomacy that was associated with it, shattered our hopes of solving lots of other problems on the wings of that, if you will. But it also occasioned the second episode I'll discuss. No one knew better than former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Colin Powell, and I was his special assistant at that time, what we had done to the armed forces of the United States in what Porter Goss in an earlier panel here, some of you may have heard him, called the peace dividend. It wasn't Bill Clinton that delivered the peace dividend, as Porter said. It was George H.W. Bush. And he delivered it because the Congress of the United States demanded it. We cut the armed forces, for example, 25%. That was a huge cut. Biggest cut since World War II, really, especially if you look at how we did it, bases and everything. Bill Clinton came along with his new Secretary of Defense, Les Aspin, and cut another 3%. Well, what relevance does that have to this? Well, it has this relevance. Powell was Secretary of State, but he was also former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and even though Dick Cheney told him that and told him not to talk military matters, he felt that it was his responsibility to say, "Mr. President, we can't do two wars at the same time." We destroyed that capability with that 28% cut in the armed forces. So you better finish Afghanistan. Nobody's arguing with you about Afghanistan. You better finish that before you do Iraq. Otherwise, you're going to neglect Afghanistan, which is exactly what we proceeded to do. So we shattered the global solidarity, and we went to Iraq with too few forces in the first place because Donald Rumsfeld decided that that would be the amount we would send. Now, some of that amount was based on give and take with the military commander, Tommy Franks, whom Powell had told on two different occasions, "You have too few troops," and whom General Shinseki had told the Congress, "We had too full troops," for which, of course, he was released. So you had too few troops to do Iraq, and that would lead to some 100,000 plus contractors being brought on to do the ultimate public function, war. And we're still living with that detritus, ladies and gentlemen, still living with it. We haven't really put it to rest yet. The other item that Powell brought to the president's attention, other than timing and force size, was legitimacy. Legitimacy in the shape of the United Nations, other allies other than Britain, and so forth. Well, we went to the UN in November of 2002, and we got a 15-0 vote, unanimous vote, approving 1441, UN Security Council Resolution 1441. Again, we had sort of resurrected a little bit of that global solidarity. But what that did was say to Hans Blix and others, El Baradei at the IAEA and so forth, that they could go and do their jobs. They could go and continue the inspections. But you can't continue the inspections if you've already marshaled 164,000 plus American forces and started them on their way. We call it in the military tip-fitting them, time, phase, force deployment data. You've already started them, and the summer's coming, the excessive heat in Iraq. So if you're doing this, you're probably going to have to cut the inspectors short, and if you're really intent on going to war, you're going to probably have to do it even without the preparation you should have. That's the second point. Third point, my boss got put out to the United Nations Security Council to give the most specious presentation on Iraqi WMD that probably anyone has ever been called on in the American government to render to not just the Security Council, they were a tertiary audience, to the American public and to the international community. And polls showed afterwards it was very effective. And why was it very effective? Because it was Colin Powell, who at that time had Mother Teresa poll ratings. He was about 77, 78% in the polls, and she was about 80%. And you're looking at the individual who went out to the CIA and prepared Colin Powell for that presentation in terms of orchestrating all the analysts from 16 different intelligence agencies, working daily and nightly with George Tenet and John McLaughlin, his deputy, and frankly, on three pillars of that presentation, mobile biological laboratories, existing stocks of chemical and biological weapons, a nuclear program, and then a fourth one, which was tantamount to the biggest lie of all, formidable contacts between Saddam Hussein and Al-Qaeda. On one occasion, Powell grabbed me, put me down in a chair in the National Intelligence Council spaces where no one else was, closed the door, and he said, take all that terrorist crap out. None of it is believable. None of it is accurate. Take it out. I said, boss, don't shout at me. I'm with you. Let's take it out. We took it out. Within 30 minutes, George Tenet was in his conference room where we resumed rehearsal, telling the Secretary of State all about an Al-Qaeda high-level operative who'd been interrogated and revealed substantial contacts between the Mukhabarat of Iraq, the secret police, and Al-Qaeda, to include training him in the use of chemical and biological weapons. That was a total, utter fabrication. The Secretary of State went to New York and gave a presentation that he believed in that had been orchestrated by a carefully orchestrated plot, if you will, between the Vice President's office, the Undersecretary of Defense for Policy in the Defense Department, and the CIA, certain analysts in the CIA who were given to me by George Tenet as gospel. And he presented that to the Security Council, the American people, the international community, to bring about the war that he had already seen destroy his strategy for exploiting the global solidarity 9/11 had produced for good, for diplomatic purposes, and destroyed any hope of legitimacy for the United States, and was based on false intelligence. It was not just an intelligence failure. It was that too. But it was orchestration of that intelligence to make it present a picture that simply was not true. And there were people in that administration who knew that. So those are my three seminal events about this particular war. And in that sense, I think I'd say disastrous decision and a disastrous aftermath. And then we've already heard about that. I could go into that in great detail too, but my time is up. Not a good time for the United States of America.
Thank you very much. I'd like to pick up where you left off. It's interesting hearing the first two speakers induced in me fits of nostalgia, because back in 2001, on 9/11, I very much viewed the world through the language and the terms that they've employed. I was living near the Twin Towers on that day. I had lost friends in the attacks, and I believed that the war on terror was one that was against people who hated our way of life, people who hated freedom, people who were hell-bent on destroying everything that we stood for. And maybe some of that is true if you think about Al-Qaeda, but what I learned very quickly is it's also much more complicated than that. I moved to Afghanistan in 2008, and I hit the road very soon after. I took a motorcycle, I lived in villages, and I got the opportunity to meet people from all walks of life. And what I learned in those trips is that those ideas, really those Manichaean ideas that I had back in 2001, I think weren't very accurate. I'll give you one example where I pulled into a village after a few days of travel and met a tribal elder who, at that point, he was maybe in his 70s or 80s, and he had lived through 30 years of war, 25 years of war. And we got to talking about the war on terror and about the American invasion. And at one point I asked him, why do you think the United States invaded your country? And he knew about 9/11, and you know, he talked about it a little bit. But for him, 9/11 was this faraway occurrence, the way maybe some famine in Africa might be for us. It wasn't at the center of the way he thought. Instead, he told me, he looked at me and he said, the U.S. invaded our country because they hate our way of life. That was a ringing phrase for me. I didn't necessarily agree with him, but hearing him put it in this way, which is the way it was talked about back in 2001, was a watershed moment for me, because it spurred me to investigate how Afghans really view the war on terror and the American war, particularly Afghans who are living in the south, where the war is being fought. So not living in those areas that are peaceful, but living in the areas where there's constant fighting to this day. And here's what I found. After 2001, Al-Qaeda had fled the country after the US invasion. And we know that, right? Al-Qaeda went to Pakistan, some of them went to Iran. Eventually, some of them regrouped in Iraq after the Iraq invasion. So after the 2001 invasion of Afghanistan, there were essentially no Al-Qaeda in Iraq. In Afghanistan, sorry. At the same time, the Taliban, from the rank and file to the senior leadership, quit. They surrendered in December of 2001. Some of them met, in fact, with Hamid Karzai, and who was being escorted by the special forces to engineer a deal. And in the subsequent months, from the senior officials like the Minister of Justice, the Minister of Defense, the Minister of Interior, aides to Supreme Leader Mullah Omar, all the way down to rank and file field commanders, surrendered and tried to switch sides. The reason these Taliban members tried to switch sides is not because they suddenly felt that they believed in the American ideals of freedom or they loved the United States, but this is how war worked in Afghanistan over the last two or three decades. I mean, if you go back to the Soviet occupation, when the Soviets left in 1989, a lot of those Afghans who call themselves communists rebranded themselves as mujahideen or holy warriors. During the Civil War in the mid-90s, people would switch sides out of nothing more than bald pragmatism, because in a conflict where things could get so deadly, you learned very quickly that you would switch sides depending on which way the wind blew. Similarly, after 2001, these Taliban members tried to switch sides. There were a number of high-profile incidents that were covered in the press at the time, covered in the New York Times and other places, in which Taliban members tried to hand over their weapons and try to cut a deal with the new officials and find a way to not be persecuted. As an example, in early January of 2002, there were efforts to raise funds for the Taliban by radical Pakistani clerics. They were going to madrasas and trying to get donations. in an effort to bring the Taliban back on their feet. At the time, Aghajan Mutasim, who was the finance minister of the fallen regime and who was close to Mullah Omar, the supreme leader, he said publicly to reporters, please do not donate to us because we are defeated, we are defunct. Please give your money elsewhere. As another example, in January of 2002, the Minister of Defense, Mullah Ubaidullah, along with the Minister of Justice and a number of other top officials, publicly cut a deal with the Afghan governor of Kandahar province and handed over truckloads of weapons in exchange for staying at home and living in immunity. So you had a particular type of situation in January or February of 2002, where you had thousands of soldiers, mostly special forces soldiers, on the ground in Afghanistan, but you had no Al-Qaeda, and the Taliban, as a military movement, was essentially defunct. So in other words, you had thousands of soldiers on the ground without an enemy to fight. But we had a political mandate, and that mandate was that we're here to fight a war on terror, and you're either with us or against us. This Manichaean worldview essentially categorized Afghans into two categories, which are either terrorists or good guys, really doing away with all the shades of gray that make the reality of Afghanistan. And so this was a contradiction. How did that contradiction get resolved? Well, in a very profound and I would say very tragic way, this contradiction got resolved, which is that the US allied with the warlords, local commanders and strongmen, and in effect, the enemies of those warlords became the enemies of the United States. Now you have to remember, back in 2002 in Afghanistan, an extremely underdeveloped country, there were no cell phone towers in most of the country. So most of the intelligence was human intelligence, not signals intelligence. And so all of the intelligence that was coming to the US, or almost all of it, was coming through local proxies, local warlords, local commanders, local figures who had a very complicated history on the ground, who had their own enemies, who had their own rivalries, who had their own hatchets to bury. And in effect, their enemies became our enemies. And so the US didn't go to Afghanistan and create a dictator. As one of you referred to, one of the options of your American policy is going and creating a dictator. Instead, what the US did in Afghanistan was create hundreds upon hundreds of small dictators in villages and in districts around the country, men who were armed to the hilt, who were paid, who were given contracts to the detriment of state building and nation building over the years. I'm going to give you an example of this, which happened to a friend of mine in Kandahar province, and he was somebody who lived across the street from me. When I met him, he was in his 80s, he was like 85 or 86 years old, and he was an old Mujahideen fighter, fought against the Soviets. But he was in retirement, and he would come sometimes to a bakery that he owned early in the morning, 4 or 5 a.m., and he would knead dough. One morning, militiamen showed up outside of his house, and his name is Sharafuddin. Militiamen showed up outside of Sharafuddin's house, and they asked for him, and he came outside. They said, "Are you Sharafuddin?" He said, "Yes." They said, "We have intelligence that you are a terrorist," and they arrested him. And he protested, of course, that he wasn't a terrorist, he was just a baker. But nonetheless, they arrested him. They handed him over to US Special Forces, who were based in Kandahar Airfield. There, he went under interrogation. He had metal hooks inserted into his mouth. Those hooks were twisted. He was beaten. They kept saying that he was an Al-Qaeda mastermind. He was a Taliban mastermind, and they were convinced of this fact because they had intelligence from Afghan warlords that this was so. He kept insisting that he was not an Al-Qaeda mastermind or a Taliban mastermind, and they could not get a confession from him. So eventually, the US forces turned him over to the Afghan militiamen, the same ones that originally captured him. These Afghan militiamen then took him to a private jail in Kandahar City, took him downstairs, a couple of floors down, and they hung him upside down. For 18 to 20 hours a day, they hung him upside down and they whipped him. He was hung with a number of other tribal elders and other people who these militiamen wanted to extract intelligence from. One of them was a very famous tribal elder from the district of Panjwai, and he was whipped so much that he was eventually killed. Sharafuddin quickly realized that what these militiamen were after was not necessarily intelligence, because there was no intelligence to give. What they were after was money. In other words, if he were to pay, he would be given his freedom. And so his family raised money, they sold some of their goods, they collected the funds, and they delivered it to his captors, and he was released. Now the problem, though, is that once he demonstrated that he was able to pay for his release, then he was a marked man. And so like clockwork, every few months, he was arrested again by the same militiamen. He was then transferred to Kandahar Airfield to the Special Forces, who accused him of being once again an al-Qaeda mastermind. He was eventually returned back to the militiamen, hung upside down, whipped until he could be paid again. Now this charade went on for about 3 or 4 years until 2005, when the commander of the unit that was arresting him was killed in a suicide attack. And the major commander of the intelligence services that ran the militia that was torturing him, he now lives in California. He was brought here, and he has many family members who are now American citizens. So this is the situation. I can repeat hundreds of stories like this. In fact, my book has many stories like this, of people who are caught in this, what we call the war on terror, which in fact, in Afghanistan, turned out to be wars against local communities in which certain warlords and certain commanders were eliminating their enemies or using the United States to gain riches, to gain power. We live with that legacy today. I think the processes that created the insurgency in Afghanistan took root in 2002 and 2003. By 2004, the Taliban had reconstituted itself as a fighting force. Leadership was now based in Pakistan, and it was very hard. The moment of opportunity that existed in 2002 had passed. It was now very hard to undo what had been done, and we're still living with the consequences of that in Afghanistan. And so I think when we think about the legacy of the war in Afghanistan and the legacy of George W. Bush, we need to think about what that means for Afghans on the ground and really interrogate why it is that fighting is still continuing in Afghanistan today. Thank you.
We're going to switch the order around just a little bit. I'm not Peter Baker. I play him on TV. I'd like to thank Hofstra and all of the staff for inviting me. I'm delighted to participate tonight. I wanted to start in discussing George W. Bush with a quote from someone who's always been a great heroine of mine, a woman named Diane Nash. Have people here heard of Diane Nash? I see some yeses. Diane Nash was a great hero of the civil rights movement. She was, at the age of, I think, 18 or 19, she was the one who really orchestrated the march in Selma 50 years ago. And last week, at the commemoration of the march on Selma, she was being honored in the front row of those who were going to march to commemorate that extraordinary experience. And at the last minute, she said this. She refused to march. And she said, and I quote, "I refused to march because George Bush marched. He was in the front row with her. I think the Selma movement was about nonviolence and peace and democracy, and George Bush stands for just the opposite, for violence and war and stolen elections, and his administration had people tortured. So I thought that this was not an appropriate event for him." I think she was right. It was not an appropriate event for him. And it's actually, I think, a good thing that he's not here today, because this is not an appropriate event for him either. I would assert that the only public event that is appropriate today for George Bush and the others of his administration is to be on trial in The Hague for war crimes. And I think that when we look at war crimes, it's important that we look at it and interrogate it more thoroughly than I think we sometimes do. Both, in my view, the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan were illegal. In Afghanistan, the claim was made that this was a war for justice and for self-defense, when in fact it was about revenge and propaganda, partly to prepare the way for the coming war in Iraq, which was the primary war. It was illegal because it was not self-defense. Article 51 of the UN Charter is very specific about what self-defense is and is not. And among other things, it says that a country has the absolute right of self-defense until the critical word, until the Security Council can meet and decide what to do about that particular crisis. Well, the Security Council met, as you will remember, those of you who aren't too young, and those of you too young to remember, I don't want to hear from you. The Security Council met within 24 hours of the attack on the Trade Center. The building was still smoldering. Diplomats had lost friends. Some had children in the area. It was a terrifying thing for people at the UN as well as everywhere else in New York, and for those of us in Washington as well. They would have, on that day, passed anything the US proposed. But the US did not propose an endorsement of the use of force. It was a very specific decision not to do that, not because it wouldn't have passed. It would have passed unanimously and with great fervor, as the resolution did. It called for a variety of things having to do with tracing the money and several other things, but it was not a resolution to be taken under the terms of Chapter 7, the criteria in the UN Charter that is the only basis for the use of force. And in that sense, it was not self-defense, and it did not meet the standard for self-defense in the United Nations. And of course, under Article 6 of the US Constitution, treaties are part of the law of the land. Treaties include the UN Charter. So that was clearly a violation. Whether or not the president makes a decision, Congress makes a decision, doesn't determine whether international law has been violated. And in this case, it was violated. In the question of Iraq, I would just say one other thing on the question of self-defense. If the US had managed to scramble a plane to take down the second plane that was about to crash into the towers, that would have been a legitimate use, horrific as it would be, a legitimate use of self-defense. Going to war 3 weeks later against a country on the other side of the world was not legitimate self-defense. In Iraq, we had many claims of why the war was legitimate. It was weapons of mass destruction. It was the possibility of nuclear weapons. It was the links to Al-Qaeda. It was yellow cake uranium. It was the aluminum tubes that could only be used for nuclear weapons. It was all these things. Well, as we know, none of those were true. It was a war fought for a host of other reasons. I'm not going to get into all of those reasons that have to do with power, the expansion of power, military bases, oil, and a host of other issues of resources and power. But I think that we do have to recognize that the region is more dangerous now because of the illegal wars waged by George W. Bush than would have been the case otherwise. And I think when we talk about war crimes, it's also important that we distinguish the war crimes that have to do with how wars are carried out from another kind of war crime. The crimes that have to do with how the war was carried out are more common in much of our discourse. So the issues of collective punishment, shock and awe, the massive civilian deaths that were known that were going to occur and the acts were carried out anyway, the thousands that were killed. The rendition, the black sites of interrogation, torture, all of those things. The determination that some prisoners somehow don't deserve the Geneva Conventions, as though that's the right of some lawyer in the US Justice Department to decide that some prisoners don't deserve to be treated under the terms of the Geneva Conventions. All of these things were illegal. All of them were war crimes. There were specific war crimes that have to do with specific violations of the Geneva Conventions. The Article 33 that prohibits collective punishment, Article 29 that says that a party to the conflict, the government of one side in that conflict, is responsible for the treatment of people living under occupation, regardless of who, what agent of that government carries out the action. That goes to the question of command responsibility and the obligations of the commander in chief, and all those up and down the chain of command to be responsible for that. We saw none of that. We saw low-level accountability against three or four people in the Abu Ghraib scandal, and nothing above very few, very low-ranking soldiers. Article 47 of the Geneva Conventions that say that people that are protected under that, under the Geneva Convention, cannot be denied protection by actions taken either by the occupying force or by the government that's in place. So things like dissolving the military and sending home 300,000 former soldiers without a job, without any way to support their family, was a violation of the Geneva Conventions. All of those are talked about, not always in the context of international law, but they're talked about a lot as the legacy, as part of the legacy of the Bush administration. What's not talked about very often is what Justice Jackson, who was a Supreme Court justice, as you all know, and also served as chief prosecutor at the Nuremberg trials, what Justice Jackson called the supreme international crime, which was, of course, not a violation of the Geneva Conventions, of the Fourth Geneva Convention, which didn't exist at that time. It was the crime of aggression, that was the fundamental crime, the supreme crime from which all the others stem. And these were wars of aggression. They were not self-defense. They were, in Justice Jackson's words, the supreme international crime. They were grounded in the concept of U.S. exceptionalism, American exceptionalism, something that has guided U.S. foreign policy from the first settlers on this land who took it as manifest destiny, their right to slaughter native people across this land, to claim the land as their own. That we are different, we are better. We have the right to do whatever we want around the world, to take the world to war, because we have been the victims of a terrorist attack. Imagine if another country were in that situation. Let's take an attack that actually did happen years earlier, in 1976. Cuba was the victim of a terrorist attack when terrorists put two bombs on a civilian airliner that crashed over the Mediterranean, killed 73 people, among them the entire young Cuban fencing team. Several government officials and other civilians were on board. It was a clear act of terror. One of the known masterminds of that terrorist act, Luis Posada Carriles, was living for many years in Miami. He was first charged at one point with an immigration violation and was briefly put under house arrest, but he was never jailed. He was never tried for the terrorist attack. What if Cuba had decided that because they had been victims of a terrorist attack, a horrific terrorist attack, that they now had the right to send drones to attack Carriles or someone else in Miami? Or to take the world to war, to revenge that attack? Would we have said, well, that's their right. They have been the subject of a terrible terrorist attack, and therefore they have the right to go to war? I don't think so. I don't think that would have been our response. The US only allows itself to violate international law with impunity and to demand that the world stand with it. That was the nature of this Manichaean point of you're either with us or with the terrorists. It wasn't just about reclaiming the global solidarity that we saw during those first hours and those first days when the world said, we are all Americans now. It was about saying, if you are not prepared to go to war with us, we will treat you as if you were terrorists, and we will go to war against you. It was that kind of Manichaean approach. And it has to do with this notion that we heard from George Bush. It wasn't on September 11th, it was on September 12th. It was September 12th, I would submit, that changed the world. Not September 11th. September 11th was a horrific crime, a crime against humanity. September 12th was the announcement that the response to that horrific crime would be to take the world to war. And what we heard was that the only choice we had was to either go to war or to let them get away with it. Unfortunately, we too often hear that same argument now. It wasn't true then, and it isn't true now. There is never only the choice of war or nothing. There are always a host of alternatives. And it's our job as students, as activists, as diplomats, as elected officials, to find those alternatives. And that's what didn't happen. Justice Jackson said something else at the time of Nuremberg. He said, and I quote him here, "If certain acts and violations are crimes, they are crimes whether the United States does them or whether Germany does them. We are not prepared to lay down a rule of criminal conduct against others that we would not be willing to have invoked against us." Justice Jackson was betrayed by George W. Bush and his administration. It was in the context of that refusal to acknowledge the reality of international law and the views of the rest of the world. And I know there are probably people here, either in the audience or listening on long distance, who don't believe international law really has any role to play, who don't believe in international law. And I would just say that for those of you in that position, you might want to think about one thing. Whether you want to accept the legitimacy of international law or not, frankly, doesn't matter very much, but it does matter in this sense. It is how the rest of the world views our actions. It is how the other 197 countries around the world view what we do. It is through that lens of international law and international legitimacy, or lack of legitimacy, that other people judge our actions. And it's for that reason that the legacy of George W. Bush is going to be that of a war criminal.
Okay, great. Can anybody hear me? So you can see I'm physically off the end of the table here, and that may also be metaphorical as well. I think what has been transpired here is fabulous, actually. As a journalist, as somebody who spends a lot of time in Washington on these debates, I very much enjoy hearing such a great diversity of points of view, a real range, and I think that I don't have very much to add, so I'll say a few words, and then maybe we can kind of continue this conversation, because I think Hofstra should be praised for bringing together people who can have a vigorous and vibrant debate about these things, all the way from a stirring and ringing defense of President Bush and his actions, all the way to a pretty sharp indictment of what he's done here. I would say that, you know, as a reporter, I was in Afghanistan in 2001 before any Americans arrived, because I was based in Moscow at the time, and the only way in actually was through Tajikistan. I spent about 8 months there in the early parts of the war, as it were, and I went from there to the Middle East and spent about 6 months in Iraq, first when Saddam was still in charge, and then during the initial phases of that war, and came back to cover the second term of President Bush. So as a journalist, had a chance to see a little bit from both sides of this period. One of the things Anand said that I thought was really on point that is important to remember is how different it looks from these different vantage points, and in fact how complicated these issues are, whether you agree with Secretary Nicholson and Tom Basile or Phyllis Bennis and Colonel Wilkerson, and I don't mean to conflate because I think everybody's making somewhat different arguments, but these are in fact such they go beyond the easy conversation. Anand mentioned the Afghan who told them they invaded our country because they hate our way of life, and it reminds me of my colleague Tom Ricks and Anthony Shadid, who were in Baghdad in the early days after the fall of the Saddam government, and they decided to test in effect this very conundrum of the different perspectives, and they each of them rode along with a military, American military procession through the city, and Tom Ricks, who was our very, very able military correspondent, rode with the American troops, and Anthony Shadid, who was our Arabic-speaking, fantastic, amazing foreign correspondent, and he's passed away, unfortunately, walked alongside and talked to the Iraqis, and the troops came away from this event and talked to Tom and said, boy, they, you know, they're waving at us and they're happy and they seem happy and to see us and very supportive. And Shadid, who was listening to them speak in Arabic, heard anger and resentment and bitterness that would fuel, obviously, a lot of trouble to come. And I think that it's that sort of disconnect that has flavored this this period in which we have tried to find solutions, and it has, I don't think, been a lot easier for President Obama. Phyllis probably have a lot to say about him as well if this were an Obama conference. But you know, this has evolved and changed over time as now two presidents have struggled to figure out what the lessons to take from it. I would actually argue that in some ways the first anti-war, if you ask too strong a phrase, sentiments that inhabited the White House after the invasion of Iraq and the invasion of Afghanistan came before President Obama actually took office, as President Bush took a different tack by his second term. And I'll tell you, the anecdote that stands out is 2007, when the Israelis come to the White House and say, we've got intelligence suggesting that the Syrians have a nuclear facility and we think you should bomb it. And President Bush gathers his team, much the same team that he had in 2002 and 2003 when he was making the decision to go to war in Iraq. And in 2002, he asked them their opinion. They all more or less said, yes, we think you should you should go, or you're ready to go. Even General Powell in the end said, I'm suiting up at that point, despite his misgivings that he had expressed up until that point. And then the president kicks them all out of the room, and it's just him and Cheney at this point. And it's just the two of them making this very fateful decision. They come out, and the president gives the order to go. Flash forward 4 years to 2007, and this question of what to do about Syria. And the president has these people, the same people in front of him, and the vice president is asked to give his opinion in front of everybody else, not separately, not just the two of them. The vice president is the only one who says, basically, we should go ahead and bomb this as a threat. You have laid down a red line on the issue of proliferation, and you should follow through on that. And the president asks, does anybody agree with the vice president? And nobody's hand goes up. And the path from that point from 2003 to 2007 just shows how much Iraq and Afghanistan had begun to weigh on even President Bush in his second term. He did not take military action against Iran despite the urgings of some. He did not take military action against Syria despite the urgings of some. He did not take military action in Darfur to try to intervene in the genocide despite desires of some. Because he too, I think, by that point, was struggling to figure out what had happened, what had worked, what had not worked. I don't think he regrets his decision per se, or at least he wouldn't say that out loud. And I think he would defend it in strong terms on some of the same terms that Tom mentioned earlier. But it's clear that by the time he left office, he himself was trying to figure out what was the appetite for military action versus diplomacy, and he had instituted the multilateral talks with Iran that we are seeing basically were continued and accelerated by President Obama, now playing out this week, in fact, in Switzerland. He engaged in multilateral diplomacy on North Korea's nuclear program and tried in the second term to repair the relations that had been damaged with the Europeans, and began to at least move some of the people out of Guantanamo and began a shift that then continued, obviously, and accelerated with President Obama. And this is what happens in this country is I think when we have national security crisis, we go to war, and we often find situations where we take actions and that end up evolving over time. Lincoln and the suspension of habeas corpus, FDR, and the internment of the Japanese, John Adams and the Aliens and Sedition Act. And I find all of that to be an important part of the overall story of how we've gotten from there to here, right, where President Obama himself is still struggling again with these very same issues and sees choices that he doesn't like in front of him, whether it come to ISIS, Iran, or Ukraine, or adding a number of different scenarios that confront him on how he chooses to respond these days. And I don't really have, therefore, more to say on that. I'd rather hear more about. Actually, I have a whole bunch of questions for everybody up here if you want to go through them, but I'll turn it back over to our moderator. Thank you very much.
Actually, you summarized everything really nicely, and I think you are really the moderator at this point, and all of us made my job easier tonight. But I do think it's a good idea because so many critical issues have been exposed and differences and different vantage points on this sort of thing to open up to some questions back and forth on the panel, I think would be most productive, in fact. And then we'll, of course, save some time for audience questions, too. But there's a lot to discuss here. We have core differences on the need for the war, issues of intelligence, the ways that wars were fought, the legality, the ethical concerns for the war, these decisions. So there's a lot on the table that I think there's a lot that could be productively debated. So with that, I guess I'll open it up if people want to have specific responses to each. Certainly, but we had panel discussion was what I was thinking first in this sense. But so actually, yeah, Peter, do you want to ask some of your questions?
Ask a few questions. I'll ask a couple questions. I guess I'm curious, Tom. I've asked Tom and Phyllis, and maybe that way you guys can bring this into sharper relief for us. Tom, you were in Iraq, and you make the argument that Jerry Bremer made logical decisions that have been criticized afterwards with regard to the army and so forth. And your argument is, that, if I remember correctly, or stated correctly, is that we went in under-resourced and we didn't properly commit to what was going to be necessary. I'm curious if you have other thoughts about what our understanding before the war of Sunni versus Shia, whether we had really, if we understood the potboiler that was there to be awakened, whether you think that more resources by itself would have actually made a difference, or how was this inevitable? And on Phyllis, I guess I would ask you talk about, they didn't ask the Security Council immediately after 9/11 whether to authorize strike against Afghanistan. I guess I'm curious, are you saying then, let's just say they had, for the sake of argument, had they asked Security Council, and as you say, the Security Council clearly would have gone along, do you think then it still would have been wise or not wise to have proceeded with the war? Was the only question to you then the question of whether the UN authorized it, or was it unwise to go in, period, despite the fact that bin Laden's people were seen to have a sanctuary there?
Okay, well that's a lot to handle. But thank you, and Peter, I enjoyed your book, and I recommend folks.
Thank you.
Fine. All right, so let's kind of address these sort of one at a time. Intel going in. Let's not forget that Secretary Powell did go to Langley for 3 days and really sit there and go through the intelligence, as the Colonel mentions. But this was not just our intelligence. We had a number of different intelligence services, including the Russians, including the French, including the Israelis. Remember, when we went to the Security Council, we didn't get a veto from the Russians. And they also understood that there was a strong likelihood that that Saddam Hussein had chemical and biological agents, and that and as somebody who's been in Saddam's 300-room subterranean bunker, which even our most powerful weapons did not penetrate, and I walked down into the dark in the flat with a flashlight and saw all the chem bio suits and all the chem bio gloves and everything around there. I often speculate, what was there? Was there anything ever there? What was he telling his leadership? And these regime elites have a very sort of cloistered sort of circle of people that they deal with. Okay, there's a lot of show. There are a lot of mirages that these authoritarian regimes have to construct in order to continue to exert authority over their regime members, but then also the larger public. I think that that's, clearly we might be able to say that that was an intelligence failure, but there were also, there were others. I mean, I remember very clearly walking in and talking to people and said, look, we had no idea that it was this bad in terms of the degradation of the physical infrastructure. So much of the resources had gone into building up the military. So much of the resources had been consolidated by the regime over a number of years that nothing worked, nothing much worked before the war, and it definitely didn't work after the war, after the looting. So, you know, when we talk about resources and we talk about intel, you have to maintain an overwhelming physical force in order to secure the secure and maintain the infrastructure, which was really the first thing that we did not do effectively. You know, nature abhors a vacuum. And when you're dealing with a situation where you're going into a country, if there is a vacuum of force, then what you're going to see is people filling that void, people filling that vacuum. And that's where you saw some of the sectarian militias. It's important to remember in Iraq that this was a non-sectarian country. There was a separation of mosque and state for many, many years. Saddam viewed himself as this Islamic leader in the Middle East really since after the first Gulf War, when he was trying to sort of reassert some of his own authority in the region. And you have intermarriage in Iraq between Sunnis and Shia. You have Sunnis, Shia, and Turkmen who were all living in the same neighborhoods in Baghdad. So when I say that when you talk to the rank and file Iraqi, these people wanted to move on with their lives. They were not saying, okay, I'm gonna, you know, this guy next door to me, he's a Shia, let's go kill him. That was not part of the psyche of this, of the country. And I believe that as the insurgency and the foreign fighters came in, you saw still the vast majority of Iraqis just want to get on with their life, but then you saw the sectarian militias start to increase in power because they felt that they could. They felt that they had that opportunity because we didn't have enough people to adequately secure the infrastructure and the streets. With respect to the army, and this is probably the most talked about issue, when you discuss the immediate aftermath. I had the benefit of actually sitting and speaking with Walt Slocum, who was the Deputy Secretary of Defense, under President Clinton, who was over in Iraq, who was one of the architects of the strategy, and actually getting in the car and going out and visiting some of these military facilities, or what was left of them. And there, I know that there are people on this panel who may say that it's a lie and there's no truth to it, but when you have a conscript army that is poorly trained, poorly equipped, poorly paid, and you have an officer corps that disintegrates above it, the rest of the army disintegrates. You have no place to billet them, you have no place to feed them, you have no place, you have no actual way to pay them because of the infrastructure breakdown. So you have to understand that unlike in the first Gulf War, where we took literally thousands of POWs who were members of Iraq's fighting force, in Iraq this time around, we took, I believe the number was less than 1,000. These guys were so poorly equipped, they actually went to the plant where they were making their uniforms and their helmets. And their helmets were like the thing that you would give to a 5-year-old kid. All right, like hard plastic. So again, a lot of this stuff was sort of for show. They had big numbers, but they were all conscripts. They had an officer corps that was essentially a patronage den of not very well trained, generals, officers, and NCOs. We had very little intelligence on the order of battle. So in terms of finding these people, particularly the senior level officers, it would have been very difficult for us to do. And the first thing that Bremer did was say, well, look, there isn't an army to really reconstitute, and what we need is a professional fighting force. In order to secure this country and ultimately put ourselves out of the game of being the only force to secure the country, we need a professional fighting force. within 60 days of his arrival, 60 days, not 6 months, not a year, not 2 years, within 60 days of his arrival, we started training the first classes of the new Iraqi army. Now remember, anybody up to the rank of colonel from the old army was able to apply, and ultimately 80% of the new army were folks from the old army. But you needed to have the components, including NCOs and officers, and places to billet these folks and feed them in order to start training people. I would like to add that we did try once, and nobody ever talks about this, but we did try once to actually reconstitute an old division of the Iraqi army. And that was in 2014 in the Battle of Fallujah. The Marines actually found a general from the old army who was actually halfway decent, all right, on paper. He actually had some training. He wasn't just a buddy of somebody, and that's how he got his rank, which is a lot of what went on in Iraq. And this guy was able to locate a core group of his NCOs and his infantry, and the Marines wanted to use them to go into the Battle of Fallujah. So they did that, and it was a complete disaster. It was a complete disaster to the point where half of those guys ended up fighting on the other side. So I know that this is an easy thing for folks to say, oh, this was a crazy idea. But as somebody who actually saw the facilities, met with these folks, and saw the operation and how that they tried to reconstitute these folks, firsthand, it was, there were certain very real reasons why that was done, and why it was tried to remedy it as quickly as possible, because we knew we had to.
Okay, very briefly, I just heard one thing that I absolutely agree with. Regime elites have cloistered groups of people around them. That was absolutely true of the White House. There were tons of people, I knew many of them, who knew far more about Iraq than anyone in the White House.
I'm glad I was able to give you some ammo. There you go.
They did not have access to the White House. I think that on the question of, what was there, the weapons, one thing we knew was true. The seed stock for biological weapons had been sent to Iraq back in the 1980s. We knew that because they came from the United States, not clandestinely, but officially. They came from a small outfit outside of Washington, where I live. It's called the American Type Culture Collection, the ATCC. And we all had the documents of this. It had been revealed many, many years earlier. And what's also true is that the use of chemical weapons during the Iran-Iraq War was done with the help of the United States military, who provided targeting information to Saddam Hussein's military. Because in that war, while the US was basically supporting both sides, kind of hoping that both sides would kill off a lot of young soldiers and would destroy a lot of resources on both sides, we weighed in more on the Iraqi side because they were the weaker side. So that was a given. The point about the destruction of how bad things were, again, there was tons of information out there about what 12 years of crippling sanctions had done. After the Iran-Iraq War, Iraq had actually managed to rebuild quite well, had rebuilt cities, et cetera. The sanctions had destroyed not only the physical infrastructure, but much of the social fabric of the country. And this was, some of you will remember the famous statement by Madeleine Albright, who said, when she was asked about the 500,000 children who had died as a result of sanctions, and her answer was, "We think the price is worth it." I gotta say, I always wanted to ask her, she had two daughters, I wanted to say, if it was your children, would you still think the price was worth it? That was her answer. She didn't deny the figure. She didn't say, oh, it wasn't 500,000 children. She knew it was. She said, we think the price is worth it. So this is not a partisan issue. This goes between parties across the board. Finally, on the question that you raised first, Peter, about if the Security Council had endorsed it, I think there's always been, and I've written a lot about this, a difference between legality and legitimacy. I would not have considered it legitimate, but it would have been legal if the Security Council had endorsed it. In 1990, for the 1991 war, the Bush 1 administration used a vast array of bribes and threats and punishments, some of which we got documentation of, to force other countries to vote in favor of the war. At the end of the day, there were only two countries that that voted no in the Security Council. One was Cuba, that voted no on principle. The other was Yemen, which had just been reunified. It was the only Arab country on the Security Council. Yemen voted no, and no sooner had the Yemeni ambassador, Abdullah El-Ishtal, put down his hand in the Security Council meeting, the U.S. ambassador to the U.N. was at his side and said, "That will be the most expensive no vote you ever cast." And the remark was picked up on a U.N. mic that he said he didn't know was open. And it became sort of embarrassing. And sure enough, 3 days later, the U.S. cut its entire aid budget to Yemen. That time, nobody cared about Yemen, the poorest country in the Arab world. It still is. But what was interesting, I think many of us, me and others, wrote at the time that we didn't think it was an accident, that we didn't think that the ambassador made a big mistake, that he knew full well that the mic was open because it was a message not primarily aimed at Yemen. It was primarily aimed at the rest of the world. If you cross us on an issue that is important to us, you will pay a price. And they still, at the UN, they call it the Yemen precedent. That's still kind of the name that that it was known by. Now, there were bribes that had to do with arms that were sold to countries like Colombia the U.S. had not been willing to sell arms because of human rights violations. There were oil deals that were cut. There were threats. There were punishments. There was a wide variety of things. But the result was they got a majority of votes. And so the war was legal. It was not legitimate, but it was legal. And that does matter. In the eyes of the rest of the world, that's an important criteria.
There are so many other issues that we could get into and discuss amongst ourselves. Missed opportunities post 9/11, missed opportunities in Afghanistan, alternatives not taken, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So many things have been risen as important issues. But let's turn it to audience questions to get in as many as we can now. And students, two things. Please try to ask short questions. And students have preference. So students, please get in as quickly as you can.
Hi. Hello. This was a great panel. Thank you, everybody. There was a lot of, in my opinion, crazy things said, so it's hard to pick out exactly what I want to question and who I want to question. I guess the main one I'd like to ask is Mr. Gopal. That was a really interesting story, and I think it's really fascinating that you lived in Afghanistan for a while. The basic gist of what I got from what you were saying is that when we got there and realized Al-Qaeda had kind of fled and the Taliban had pretty much quit, should we have just packed up and gone home and let them go back to Afghanistan and plan another attack? Like, what would, you know, in my opinion, it sounded like you were saying we should have just, you know, let the country go back to exactly what it was, which was one of the worst countries in the world, run by the worst people in the world, which was the Taliban, where women have no rights. We could go on and on about how bad they were. They were obviously going to return if we left. So what do you think we should have done instead?
Well, there was a real opportunity at that point in 2002 and 2003. What I would like to draw attention to is two different concepts. One is state building, one is counterterrorism. And I think those two are actually counterposed to one another. The experience of Afghanistan shows that, because for every dollar that was spent on the central government on building institutions, there was an equivalent amount built on spent on building personalities and strong men and warlords. I'll give you an example of this, and then I'll answer your question, which is that the Afghan National Police, there was an attempt to build a national police force in Afghanistan. There's a number of ways in which one can build a police force, one of which is to create a national academy, to train people, to hire people from around the country. Instead, what ended up happening was that the police force that was built was a conglomeration of local militias. And the militias that were chosen were those that were most effective in killing bad guys, or people who were deemed bad guys. Not those who were most effective in providing law and order. And the effect of that was that now today we have militias all around the country. The police are considered probably the most rapacious of the Afghan security forces. So in 2002, what were the options? Well, if we were serious about state building, that would have meant not privileging at every step of the way militias and strongmen, but instead privileging the building of institutions, helping the Afghan state actually collect taxes instead of propping it up. All of that, I think, would be a very tall order and be a radical break from the paradigm which has dominated the last 13 or 14 years, which is counterterrorism. And I think that would be an alternative. I don't believe that actually would have happened. I don't believe that, given the state of affairs in 2002, that all of a sudden the United States would have been serious about state building. It was never serious in Afghanistan about state building. As another example, last week I was in Kandahar province, and I was traveling around looking at schools because I was interested in the question of education, because supposedly the United States has helped bring education to millions of Afghans post-2001. Well, it turns out that, particularly in the South, many of these schools that were built were actually contracted to local warlords and strongmen, and the building of these schools actually deeply damaged local communities in ways that probably would have been better off if they had never done so in the first place. So, you know, the broader answer to the question is that if the U.S. was serious about state building, then it had to be serious about actually building institutions. Instead, it was only into or only focused on counterterrorism, and now we have no state and terrorists. Well, it depends where you look. I mean, there are parts of the country where life is significantly better today than it was under the Taliban. There are parts of the country where life is worse today than it was under the Taliban. And I'll focus on the latter part just because it's so counterintuitive. In southern Afghanistan, for women, under the Taliban, women were locked in their homes. They were kept away from education. They were kept away from healthcare. Today, in southern Afghanistan, women are still locked in their homes. They're kept away from education. They're kept away from healthcare. And on top of that, they live in a war zone where their husbands or their brothers can run over roadside bombs, or they can be taken away in night raids, or they can be droned. I was just in southern Afghanistan, and I didn't see a single woman the whole time I was there. So it's a very complicated question, but I think the starting point is, as Phil said, is to ask, you know, for whom is it better? And for many, many Afghans, actually life is not better. And that, I think, more than anything else, is a searing indictment of everything that's happened in the last 13 years.
Hi, this is a question for Peter Bagel, but first, before I do, like the other gentleman here, thank you all for giving up some of your time to come and talk to us. Greatly appreciate it. Mr. Baker, you had mentioned that you had worked with a colleague named Thomas Ricks. It turns out that a couple months ago, I happened to have read a book for my Politics and the Press class called Fiasco, a book you probably know very well. And with that being said, what do you think can be taken from Mr. Rook's books and be applied right now to what's going on in Iraq and Afghanistan? What do you think can be taken?
Well, that's a great question. I don't want to answer for Tom, because Tom would be a better person to give you lessons from his book. But his book, you know, I think was a fabulous encapsulation of a lot that had gone wrong in Iraq. I remember when he came into the newsroom and said he was going to write the book. And from the very beginning, he said, my title's going to be a fiasco. And we're like, really? You think that? My only worry, I said, some of us said, well, you think it might be a little strong, because it hadn't yet actually gotten quite as bad as it was going to get. He says, no, I think actually my worry is somebody else will do it first. And he was right. He had a very good sense of it through his military contacts. He had a lot of experience with these officers, and he was seeing it through their lens, as the story we mentioned with Anson Shadi. You know, I think Tom later wrote the next book called The Gamble, about Petraeus and the Surge. I think that book, you know, will come away with some lessons that may have flowed from Fiasco, and some of them didn't actually flow from Fiasco. And I wouldn't want to give his view. I think Tom, who's left the Washington Post now, wrote a very evocative piece recently for Foreign Policy. I think it was a Foreign Policy, which my wife used to edit, about how he is, because he's got a blog there called The Best Events, about how in the last number of years he's been sort of, I'm not sure he used the word radicalized, but but he now has a much more, I guess liberal would be the right word. You know, I mean, having been an objective reporter who was very tight with the military for many, many years, he's come away very sour, obviously, very, very, depressed isn't the right word, but very, actually, it may have been the right word. He talked about having sort of a post-traumatic stress after having covered so much of the awful things that had happened, and it's made him rethink things. I think this period has made a lot of people who did feel strongly about the war, and it is important, by the way, to remember that this was a bipartisan vote in Congress when it was taken in 2002, and there was, you know, there were quite a lot of people across the ideological and party, as Phyllis has pointed out, lines who supported things and who have changed their view, have become quite distressed in some ways or another. I think Colonel Wilkerson obviously can speak for himself, but I think that there's very few people who come from the administration with a stronger and more vigorous feeling than the Colonel has had about what happened, why it happened, why it shouldn't have happened, and so on. So I don't have any good lessons for you. I would leave that to smarter people than me. But
let me touch on another point that you and every young person in this room and across the country should be concerned about, that this is really highlighted, and this is 14 years of war. The Gates Commission that set up for President Nixon and created the all-volunteer force, and Tom has talked about this too, made a mistake. It made a number of mistakes. It didn't contemplate anything like this, for one thing, and it didn't contemplate what would happen once 1% of the nation was bleeding and dying for the other 99%, particularly for extended period of time and over the active and the reserve components. So the all-volunteer force right now, and I recommend a book to you by Major General Dennis Leitch called Skin in the Game. The all-volunteer force in the Army and Marine Corps alone will be almost the entire portion of the defense budget for those services in another 15 to 16 years at present rate of increase. The all-volunteer force is not working. Think about what you have to do if you give a war and no one comes. Now, Phyllis would probably say that'd be wonderful. But I'm not quite that far yet.
Give it a month.
One reason we've gone from 2% women in the force to 14% has nothing to do with egalitarianism. It has to do with we can't find the men. We have lowered the standards in the Army and Marine Corps so far that we're taking criminals. We're taking people with drug records. We're taking people who are mentally unstable. It is incredible what we've done to the armed forces. And the reserves have become an operational reserve rather than a strategic reserve as they've been for so many years. And they are being broken too. Think about that, young people.
Can I add just a point about the military? I work a lot with Iraq Veterans Against the War, which is an extraordinary organization of mainly young, although they're not so young anymore, veterans of both Iraq and Afghanistan. And one of the things that we've talked about a lot is what the statistics showed, particularly from Iraq, Afghanistan as well, about who it was from the U.S. who was dying in those wars. And after age, they were all young, the single most common thread among those thousands who were killed in this war from the US was that they were from either rural areas or towns of less than 25,000. They were not from big cities. They were from places where there were no jobs. There was no way to really, there was no opportunity to go to school. They weren't necessarily, many of them were very impoverished. They weren't necessarily so, but they didn't have options. They didn't have other choices. And because they were from these small towns scattered around the country, they were not from the big cities where overwhelmingly people who work in the media come from. So that people who work in the media today, and I have many friends in the media, and the work that I do is the same thing, we don't know.
Some of your best friends are media.
Some of my best friends are media. And me and my best friends know very, very few people in the military. And part of the reason is I know lots of people who don't know anyone in the military, or anyone who's ever been in the military of this generation. And that's a reflection of who it is that's being drafted by lack of opportunity and lack of other choice, lack of job, poverty, a range of things. It's not quite as volunteer as the name sounds, in my view. But it means that those who are writing the history of today in the newspapers, online, on blogs, in the radio, on TV, often don't have a clue who these people are who are fighting. And that affects how the coverage happens, what does and doesn't get covered. So that's one of the aspects that we have to look at when we look at the problems facing the military today.
Carl Melantis, who is the author of Matterhorn, probably one of the best books about war I've read since All Quiet on the Western Front, former Marine in Vietnam, calls it the all-recruited force, and that's what it is. And you would be stunned if I gave you the figures on what the Army alone spent to recruit that force, especially during the height of the Iraq conflict. We're talking about $6 or $7 or $8 or $9 billion being spent just to pay for this all recruited force. And it isn't getting much better.
Yes, so let's take advantage of us having nothing behind us and do one more question, because we're actually at 9 o'clock now, so.
This is for Phyllis Bennis. You mentioned earlier that there are a lot of alternatives instead of going into war into Afghanistan after 9/11. Can you mention some of those alternatives that the U.S. government could have taken instead of going to war?
Sure. One of the great things I got to do when I wrote this book about 9/11 and what was different and not different in U.S. foreign policy was write the speech that George Bush should have given when he brought the helicopter down to land when he was circling around. I think that the first thing was to recognize it as a huge crime against humanity rather than an act of war, which implies another country is somehow guilty. Going to war against Afghanistan when the hijackers were not Afghans, they were Saudis and Egyptians, they hadn't trained in Afghanistan, they trained in Germany, they had went to flight school in Minnesota, and here we were saying we're gonna bomb Afghanistan, was certain to create more terrorism later. So the first thing would be to recognize what's going to create more terrorism and don't do that. That meant recognize it as a crime, recognize the need for international justice. There was a lot of talk about justice. It should have been a moment to say, this is why we need a viable, functional system of international justice, why we were wrong to oppose the International Criminal Court, why we were wrong to weaken it, even though we had no intention of signing on to it at the time it was negotiated. And in that context, to say, first, too many people have died today. And I'm, as president, I'm going to make the pledge, not one more person is going to die in the pursuit of justice for those who did die. That's not a way to bring justice. So it means treating it as a crime, treating it with international engagement, not telling the rest of the world, you're either with us to go to war, you either support our war, or we will treat you as if you were terrorists. It means cooperation. It means police cooperation. It means engaging, not militarily, but through law enforcement, to do some of the things that the UN was called on to do and was never given the resources to do very well in terms of identifying funding sources, for instance. The fact that the US refused to put pressure on its key ally, Saudi Arabia, which was known to be the source of much of the funding for al-Qaeda in that stage and today. The U.S. is too worried about the relationship with Saudi oil, the relationship with the Saudi monarchy, the military role of the Saudis, et cetera. It means putting aside all of those concerns that have to do with the usual diplomatic relationships. It means improving diplomacy and taking seriously the need for diplomacy. These are lessons that we need to be applying now when we look at what to do about ISIS. The choice is never go to war or do nothing, go to war or let him get away with it. It means putting enormous amounts of resources, money, people, the best minds available to figure out what kind of negotiations would work. Not necessarily negotiations directly with ISIS or back then directly with al-Qaeda, but negotiating with those who are enabling al-Qaeda. Who's funding them? How do you put pressure on them? Those questions were not only never addressed, but those who said they should be addressed, those who said that if we want to prevent this from happening again, we have to understand the root causes of why it happened in the first place, those were called I was one of them, many of us were, we were called apologists for terror. That if we weren't supporting war, we were somehow apologizing for terror. We were somehow supporting terror. We were sucking up to Saddam Hussein. It was, I mean, the insults were pretty constant. That was what we needed to do, was figure out root causes. Maybe you can't prevent an extremist of some sort, who's a sociopath of whatever sort, from a kind of attack, but you can damn well figure out why people in many places around the world think that maybe it wasn't such a bad idea, and look at what those reasons are, and try and figure that out, which makes it much harder to ever do it again. So if your goal is to prevent it from ever happening again, you have to start with figuring out why it happened the first time. We know it wasn't because they hate our freedoms. They don't hate our freedoms. They hate the fact that we're denying them their freedoms. So it was a huge challenge that was never met. There's always alternatives. And you need to put your best minds, the best influx of resources, of money, of time and attention and people to figure out what those alternatives are, rather than going to war as the only alternative.
You know, and just in response to that, and sort of stretching for how to actually address that, you know, Ms. Bennis says that it wasn't really an act of war. Well, I'll kind of finish where I started, and that the paradigm of what we consider to be war has shifted. And this is our new time, this is the change that we've seen in our world, these are the new challenges that we face. And you know, and this speaks to something that the Colonel said earlier, that we wasted an opportunity because we went into Iraq. And there can be no doubt, in the Colonel's defense, there can be no doubt, certainly, that George W. Bush burned a lot of capital going into Iraq. But don't ever think that just because you hear about Iraq or Afghanistan in the news, that that was the extent of what this president did to keep us safe. George W. Bush, and for those of you who think on the panel that, well, you know, we just threw lots of bombs and killed lots of people in Iraq and Afghanistan, and this was the strategy. This government, after 9/11, initiated operations in conjunction with the FBI, the CIA, the US military, and the intelligence agencies and governments, working together with governments of 62 countries to interdict terrorism. And we had the cooperation of 62 countries for different types of operations, intelligence gathering, diplomacy, economic pressure, military pressure, and other types of work to interdict terrorist networks. This wasn't about sort of identifying Al-Qaeda as the only threat and then saying, okay, well, if we're done there, we're done, we're finished, we're moving on. The president had a much more global view of this, and he had the relationships, and the administration built relationships with, productive relationships with countries all around the world to help not only protect our interests, but also to protect theirs. So while, yes, political capital was burned, I think that bold decision-making makes that a necessity. But please don't think that Iraq is the only estimation of what George W. Bush did to keep this country safe and to initiate an effort that had global participation, global cooperation, and global reach to interdict terrorism.
I want to ask a question, if I can, of the young man who asked the question to Phyllis. I'm burning to know your answer to this, Phyllis.
I'm here for you.
While your response to the young man's question might be intellectually appealing to me, and it might even comport with my more humane side, how would you ever get the American people not to impeach you?
Oh, that's an easy one to answer. I think that at the time of 9/11, you know, we go back in history and we remember nobody was alive at the time of 9/11 who had ever seen an attack on US soil by a foreign country. the attack on Pearl Harbor, Hawaii was not a state at that time. This was unprecedented in the life of everyone in this country. And people were terrified. People were desperate for leadership. There was a moment when I know that people, many people, would have followed any kind of leadership. And there was a danger. You know, that's a very dangerous moment in the lives of countries, that people can be pushed to take positions that they would never take in normal times, when you have an abnormal situation. And if people were desperate for leadership, if that leadership had given another alternative, I think there would have been massive support from the United States to stand with the French saying, we are all Americans now, to stand with the people of the world who were sending these messages of solidarity and human connection, in many cases for the first time. It was the first time in a generation or more that Americans had looked vulnerable to anyone else in the world. That had never happened before. I think the vast majority of people in this country would have wanted to follow that kind of leadership. We were never given that option.
How would you explain that 51 to 52% continue today to identify themselves with thinking torture is necessary?
It's gone up and down. I mean, 88% of people supported the war in Afghanistan at the time that it was presented. By 3 years ago, 82, I think, or 83, I forget the exact number, were saying it was never worth it. Now, obviously, that included a lot of the same people. So, you know, statistics are a snapshot. They're useful for gauging where public opinion is at any given time, depending on how the media is covering stuff, depending on what political leaders say. And we all use statistics. It's not to say they're not valid. But they're limited, you know. It depends how you ask the question.
No, I understand that. It's one of my gravest concerns about the American people.
It's huge.
That they continue to support torture.
And if people are going to believe that it works and somehow it's legal because some lawyer in the Justice Department said it was legal, it's the ultimate tautology. It's legal because someone asked me, do you think it's legal? I think it's legal, therefore it's legal. That's not how the law works in this country. When we say this is a country of laws and not of people, I mean, they used to say it was a country of laws and not of men, but we don't do that anymore, thankfully. So if it's a country of laws and not of people, that means the laws have to have some credibility, not just some lawyer who happens to have graduated law school to say, yeah, I think it's, you know, whether it was John Yoo or somebody else to say, yeah, I think it's legal, and therefore the president can do it. And somebody else says anything the president does is ipso facto legal. That doesn't make it legal. It just means somebody's saying it's legal. And you're going to get a lot of people to believe it because nobody is saying the opposite.
We have already taken over our time and imposed a lot on of our panelists, but I want to thank them for illuminating discussion, lots of great debate, so many issues we could still continue to cover. Hopefully we'll continue this discussion throughout the rest of the conference, but thank each and every one of you for coming and making this a very informative, interesting panel. Thank you.
According to Dennis in his book, about 2007, 2008.
I know of examples of kids that, you know, have been in trouble with the...
You know what I have for you, Peter?
I know that's not true because my son's an older. He's a lieutenant colonel. Okay.
This is one of the.
I know that's not true. No, it makes it not true because.
That's the one on.
What
so what should the U.S. do?
I
thought you might explain.
So Dennis's got. Read the book. He's
oh,
got
the back.
Stats
that's
in there. They're very disturbing.
That's
very disturbing. Look at the drone problem the Air Force has right now too. The Air Force is training 180 pilots a month. They're losing 240. I think the main reason they're losing them is because of the way they're having to drive them, and of course the loss exacerbates that. They're going 4 days, 12 hours all day long, 4 days, they have a day off, and they're going 4 more days. Then they have 3 days off, then they have 4 more days on. It's driving them. Oh, yeah. Well, some of it is, but a lot of it is right now in the Syria theater. Yeah, the Air Force, Secretary of the Air Force said the other day, she drives about, she don't know what you're going to do. It's a problem that they don't see a solution. Part of it is because drone pilots are very unglamorous bases, like Crete and Syracuse. And part of it is the fighter mafia and the bomber mafia, looking down their nose.